What we have here is a 555 timer circuit, the simplest one you could possibly come up with. If you search for a circuit, the simplest 555 circuit, you're going to find a couple of examples of how to do that. Here's one of them implemented. What I'd like to do is adjust the potentiometer and see if I can't increase the frequency of the blink. I think if anything, it's going to get longer. Looks like it's going to hold on. It's going to hold high for several seconds, maybe even longer. I'm not really sure. The way I began this circuit was I had two 100K resistors as a voltage divider between pins 8, 7, and 6 on the 555. Is that right? I think so. And now my screwdriver won't turn this thing. Get some better. I don't think that's going to work either. What you need a flathead screwdriver to turn this. So, let's see. Let's get some blink happening. Well, that's like kind of a... You know, there's something pleasant about this frequency, and I'll tell you. I come from the 20th century, and I remember the early 70s technology for like road signs and whatnot. And you'd have a blinking light like this, or maybe you'd have a stoplight that would blink about that rate in a small town. One of the towns I grew up in at one point just had, like a lot of towns, just had one stoplight. That was a blinking red light about that frequency. What is that? One thousAbout a second. Well, regardless, I'm just enthralled with the 555 timer, and I'd like to learn a lot more about it. So I think this is a great circuit to get started with. Now, on this side of the breadboard, I shall reveal the same circuit over wax paper, because I have a terrible idea, which is I'm going to hot schmoo the circuit onto the wax paper, take the paper off once the glue dries, and solder it up as a test before I do anything else. So it'll be dead bugged together in a way that makes sense to me, hopefully. I don't know, I've never tried this before. This is an experiment. I don't know what hot glue is going to do to wax paper. Is it going to stick real good? Is the wax going to melt off and somehow bond with the glue? I don't really know. Wax paper being kind of waxy on both sides, this is like organic wax paper. It's brown. I don't really know what its composition is, what it's going to do or anything. So let's find out. The whole reason I got reinterested in the 555 circuit is because, long story short, I had a leak under my kitchen sink, and I happened to have a plastic tray catching the drips. Well, the tray was beginning to overflow, and I thought, well, why don't we set up kind of a alarm system? Let's see, I think this side's paused. There we go. So basically, I want to solder these wires, these leads, to a pair of copper tape leads, something like that, contacts, cathode and anode situation, and have the battery as part of that switch, obviously, so that when the water level gets high, it triggers this. Now, there we go. Now that's using two 100K, are they 100K or 1K? This is the problem. They are brown, black, red. Resistor. So the resistors kind of determine the frequency as well as that's not exactly true. There's a capacitor on here, and that determines the frequency, and then the two resistors act to also determine the frequency. And it's a bit mysterious how they do that to me. Intuitively, I don't understand it yet, but that's the whole point of this. This is a simple enough circuit that if I can learn how it works and why it works the way it works, then anybody can. So if you watch the video that I did about soldering with hot schmoo, then you know that I've become an abuser of the hot schmoo, and I never meant to be an abuser of hot schmoo. The problem is that it's so darn convenient. Its fit and finish is repulsive. It's absolutely not reliable as an adhesive. It's got a lot of cons, but what I have found its strength is for quick slap and dash prototyping to keep stuff from jiggling around. It's perfectly acceptable for that. It has no structural value as a building material, and glue guns are hot and dangerous in your shop. And I've seen things catch on fire in shops caused by this, just neglect. So mostly heat guns, not glue gun, but glue guns can get hot enough to burn you, so you ought to be careful. But anyways, let's try to solder this. Let's hot glue this slightly onto the wax paper and then see what happens. The hot glue gun appears to be hot, so we're gonna go for it. This is probably a terrible idea, but whatever. Here we go. Now, I've noticed that hot glue, when it's warm, conducts electricity Kind of. I think I seen that once with something I was hot gluing that was electrified, and the LED suddenly on this particular circuit turned on and it was dim, but that told me that there was some kind of conductivity. Perhaps all these little molecules jumping around at speed. That's always nice. Run out hot glue mid. Don't be shy with hot glue. You gotta go all in. Aesthetically, I know, it's terrible. It is terrible stuff. There we go. The hot schmoo has been unleashed upon this circuit. I will give you this example, though. The place where hot glue is really incredible is for doing, what do you call, stress relief on wires that you soldered together, especially audio cables and the like. So that's ugly, but it's structurally going to hold together for a bit. And all one must do is cover up the mess. Oh, we're going to need more. Never underestimate how many windings of black tape. It's less alert. Ta-da! Still ugly, but at least you know somebody's trying. The hot glue is dry. Hot schmoo appears to be congealed, more or less. I'm kind of scared to actually do this. Well, it's not pathetic. It's strange. The important thing here is to remember the orientation. So, because we're going to remove the paper next, and then just solder up each line, right? And thereby debugging the circuit. The byproduct is there'll be a bunch of hot schmoo left over. Kind of like from constructing a tunnel. There's always some tunnel digging machine that they've burrowed into the ground. Seems like a waste, but in this case, it's just hot schmoo. We don't care. Let's actually see how this goes. That was easy. Hot glue does not stick to wax paper at all. Good to know. I know. Don't encourage me. Think of what we can do now. Interesting. Very interesting. It's like cake frosting. I think the least I should do here is trim off any excess disgustingness. Is it possible? Can one cut this cleanly? Screwing everything up. Yeah, I know, there's a thing called printed circuit boards, and it only costs a few dollars, and we're gonna get there. But I don't have a lot of money to spend and waste on experimentation, so I try to do stuff like this where I can at least figure out the fit of a circuit into its enclosure and work out any bugs before I order boards. Or before I go to the trouble of debugging something without breadboarding at first. A lot of times, as you know, it doesn't work. It just doesn't work. So I like to breadboard first. Everything. Over and over again. We got the hot glue machine fired up here. The hot metal glue machine, that is. I think the best thing at this moment is to just tin up all the ends. Because what I want to do here is get... That is some smoky-ass solder. No, it's smoky because put a little Dutch Boy flux. I dipped the whole thing in a little bit of Dutch Boy flux. And the reason I did that is because flux just makes it a little bit better. A little bit smokier. Oops, and then we got a problem. So we got some schmoo on the... I left my insulation snipper tool inside the house. So I'm gonna have to resort to field techniques. Deal with. To do a dead bug is you use a piece of wire and clip, solder and clip. How is that gonna go? Your guess is as good as mine. Of course, nothing like all that, you know, oil from the skin to get on the wire to not make it not want to bond. So again, flux. There's a reason to use flux. It's a terrible reason. It smokes up the whole shop, but oh well. So I've pre-tinned this wire. That ought to help, right? If I can only see the bloody thing down here, can it be done? Now, I think we did okay on that. We only have to do this 7 more times. But the idea is that we're gonna just clip off. Pinch and go. Pinch and go. All right, well, I finished up soldering this thing, debugging it, and it took a few minutes longer than I would have liked. And I ran into the problem where I got too much solder on joining two of the legs of the IC. So I had to deal with that. I wouldn't say she's a thing of beauty, but she works. Well, there you have it, a couple of 555 timer circuits lighting up a warning LED in this case. And this one debugged using the hot schmoo technique, which is, it works. It's a little bit problematic in that anytime you're soldering a chip, that's a bad sign. It means you ought to be using an IC mount of some kind so that you're not damaging the internals. But that said, got out of this one alive. Next up on this circuit, we'll be putting copper tape leads and something like this. Yeah, yes, well, there you have it. It's interesting. Now, I wonder if I could re-breadboard this. I ought to be able to, except for I clipped some of the leads off, though, so no, well, it's not going to work. Interesting idea, though. This is the first time I've done it, and it actually worked, which makes me curious about maybe doing some more of these like this. You know, and then once you really can rely, you know, use the circuit in the field for a little bit. Go get it, you know, spend the $20 and get 5 or 6 boards made up using the usual software and one of the handful of good mail order circuit printing companies out there. I'm actually pleased that that works. Now, I wonder if I could get the hot glue off of there. And this would be possibly skookum at that point. Possibly. Maybe. But this does add a lot of stress relief, so I ought to leave it on. I mean, the point is not to make a skookum dead bug. I mean, it could be, but that's not what this video is about. I just wanted to get this circuit going, so yippee skippy. Have a good one.